I guess I really don't care if it's dangerous or not. I'm going to town either way. Don't worry, I'm not crazy. At least, I don't think so. I was weak. That's why I needed you. Needed you to punish me for my sins. That's all over now. I know the truth. Now it's time to end this.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here, and welcome to episode 14 of The Codec, our interview with Guy Sihe. How you doing this morning, sir?
Hello, Clayton. I'm well. Hey, fellas.
How's it going?
Nice to have you here. As always, joined by my two co-hosts, Corrupt Ronan.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Corrupt Ronan here, also known as That One Black Guy. Thank you guys for joining me today. I always appreciate it. Thank you to Guy here for joining us as well. It's a pleasure to talk to you, sir.
And
thank
Yong,
you.
Yeah.
What's up, everybody? It's Yong here, and welcome to our interview with Guy Sihe. I'm also known as That One Asian Guy, by the way. And it's awesome to have you here, Mr. Sihe, and we can't wait to dive into all the work that you have done for us in the gaming industry. So thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me, fellas.
Sure. All right. And Yong, I actually believe you're going to open up today's questions.
Yes. So we always like to start with this question. Just tell us a bit about yourself. Who is Guy Sihe, and how did you get into voice acting, and how did you eventually end up playing the role of James Sunderland in Silent Hills 2?
Oh, I started acting when I was just a teen, actually, and I was acting in school, like those kids, you know, who like to be in the school shows. I did that a lot, and then my father.
I'm one of them.
Yeah, my father made documentary films about the Soapbox Derby, which I built a car and raced in. So those films became fairly popular. He made a series of them, and they were circulated back to schools on 16 millimeter film back in the 70s. So and 80s, I guess. So I started doing that early. And then when I had a job, my first job in Japan was with a publishing company. And I kind of mixed my hobby of adventure travel together with the business side. And I started publishing a series of books and videos, like workbooks with videos for learning English. And so we went to Amazon River. We went to the Taklamakan Desert. We went to Mount Everest and filmed. Wow. And then I narrated the videos. So I realized that's when people first started saying, oh, you have a nice voice. I hadn't really thought of it that way before, but I took them sincerely. And then, of course, getting involved with Silent Hill came a little later after I had sold out of that company and was living in Italy for a year. And my older children were living in Tokyo. So I was flying back and forth between Florence, where I was living, and Tokyo. And then my daughter said, asked if I could take her to a she didn't say Silent Hill 2. She said a PlayStation 2 game audition. So I said, sure, I would take her. And then while I was at the audition, I asked if I could audition too, just for shits and giggles. I really didn't expect to get a job. I know that auditioning gives you an adrenaline rush. So I you know, I'm an adrenaline junkie. So I went for it.
Nice.
Wow.
And that's how that happened.
Wow. That's very awesome. Interesting. Wait, so Japan, Italy, you've been to a lot of places, it seems.
Yeah, I have. I've been all over the world over the years. I've been to the North Pole twice.
Oh, wow.
That's cool.
Whoa.
Yeah, I jet skied down the Rio Negro, which is the fourth largest river in the world.
Wow, so
that's awesome!
I can entertain my children when they're young, anyway, with stories about Piraiba, swimming with the piranha.
Wow,
that's very cool.
Can you speak multiple languages, like Japanese, by any chance?
Hai, Nihongo wa dekimasu.
Whoa, okay.
少しフランス語はできましたけど、もう忘れちゃった全部。
It's very natural too, sound. It's very like fluent.
Hi. That's all I'll say about that.
Yeah. Wow. That's really impressive.
Well, after 30 years, I should be able to do something. Yeah,
when did you move to Japan?
1985.
Oh, wow. How old were you?
I was 27.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
Yeah. That's and awesome. I was like vice president of this company, which I don't know. I suppose that's something.
Yeah, it is.
Used to be somebody.
Well, I think our next question comes from Ronan. Ronan, what do you have for Guy?
Okay, so I know you mentioned a little bit about what led you up to auditioning for Silent Hill, but was there any former interest that you may have had in the franchise that may have had some part in your auditioning for that role?
Absolutely none.
Oh, really?
I had no idea what it was. I walked in and I had no idea what we were there for. All I knew was where we had to be and what time, and that it was a PlayStation 2 game. And that's all my daughter knew, for that matter. They didn't really say much on the poster. There was a poster at her school, and it said open auditions, 12-year-old girl, needs to speak English, like that.
Huh. So was this in Japan or here in America?
Oh, no. It was at in Tokyo.
Okay.
Yeah, you would see that here in America, to see advertising in a school or something like that's crazy.
Well, these guys are top professionals. That's how they landed me by total accident. So it wasn't always the way it is today. We didn't have Norman Reedus playing parts in the In fact, most of the voice talent in the early days, back when I did Silent Hill 2 and prior to that, were commercial television and radio voices. So they had an agent, and then when there was casting calls, they would contact the agents, and they'd get the standard group of professionals who go into a booth and do their thing. They've got like Dave Shoffley, who's a really close friend now. I met through, he played Eddie.
Yep.
Sorry about the basketball in the background. I'm in the hallway next to the gym. And Dave can do like 20 different voices, and he can even talk to himself, and you might not know that he's playing both characters. So he's quite professional. Donna is that way as well. She played Angela. Yeah. And Monica and I are not. We had studied acting, method acting, mm-hmm. Kaczynski, right, and all that stuff. And then we never acted after we got our careers going. So both of us had a little like adrenaline rush at being selected and then suddenly having a part to play. And I think basically we started out playing each other or trying to keep up with each other. I was trying to keep up with her. Okay, there's the truth. Yeah, she's great. And so we really put a lot into it that doesn't go into voice acting generally.
Right.
And we didn't know any better. It's simply because we didn't know that we're only supposed to work so many hours because we're only getting paid so much. For us, it was just fun. And we did all of our work, writing our backstories and then comparing notes as to who we are as characters. There wasn't a lot. I would ask, are there limitations on how we interpret the role? And they didn't really even know what I was talking about because they hadn't studied acting either.
Yeah.
So it was fun. I think Monica and I ran away with it because we're like kids with a new toy, and we had time. We were both not with regular jobs at that time, so it was easy to get carried away with.
Wow. So you actually got to kind of create your own backstory for the character? They actually let you kind of do that?
Absolutely.
That's
probably
awesome.
I still have it written down somewhere.
Wow. I'd love to hear
really
that
cool.
sometime. That's awesome.
Some ways it doesn't match with the liner notes, the game notes, but that's okay.
It is, because the characters, it's really, really great. A lot of people refer to Silent Hills 2, excuse me.
Silent 2 Hill.
Yes, they refer to that game as one of the best games of all time. I think it would be cool to kind of dive into what you thought of the character at another time, if we can maybe have you back on the show at a different date. But my first question for you, Guy, is being that game came out in the late thousands, like real early thousands, and now you're doing some voice work now, how much different is it as far as the evolution of being a voice actor. You talked a little bit about it was kind of a non kind of professional way to get hired. You just went in for an audition. They didn't know who you were, that kind of thing. And then nowadays you see people that are famous movie stars and stuff like that grabbing these roles. Can you tell us a little bit about your perspective on how the voiceover industry has kind of evolved since then?
Yeah, very briefly, I think, let me take you into my private office here.
Oh, wow.
All right.
All right.
Very briefly, I think it's shifting from amateurs to professionals. And I, you know, with all due respect, I believe that most of the voice talent that were doing games prior to, say, 2005 were amateurs. I mean, they were guys who did TV commercials or jingles or radio commercials in English.
Right.
And they have beautiful voices, but they're not actors. And then what you had was Disney animating movies throughout that period, educating the industry how to act with your voice. And people are getting better at it. I'm just pleased as I can be that people respect the work that I did in downplaying the role and underplaying and bottling up James's feelings, and also respect the work that Monica put in to split her personality the way she, that was awesome. So like you take Norman Reedus, I have no doubt that he would be fantastic in a game if he took one. And I don't know, I think fans were kind of split on the fellow who did 24, that Kiefer, when he stepped into
Sutherland? Yeah,
he stepped into Metal Gear Solid, and I think
was
a bit of a, I'm not sure that he was right for it or not. What do you think about that? Did he fit in?
Oh, Lord.
Here's the thing. I think he does a great job, but, you know, it's split. Some people say, you know, David Hayter is the voice of Metal Gear, of Snake.
Right.
Whereas other people say, hey, Kiefer, actually, he's a veteran actor, and it shows through his voice acting. And I don't know. It's split. It's divided.
Yeah.
Well, I like it personally.
Okay, well, there you go. I mean, to answer your question, games are so big now, so much money goes into it. What
God, we're getting some static on your end. There we go. Okay,
so games are so big now, and we're putting in... Oh, can I ask you a question? Are we going to do this live, or is this...
Yeah, this is live.
This is live, okay.
Yep. A couple hundred people watching right now.
Oh, great.
no pressure.
So be honest.
So be honest, right? I'll be honest. I got to run out and get my bag because I left it outside. So I'm going to go white out for a minute, but
I'll
keep talking.
That's perfectly fine.
I think the sound is so much nicer out here. Maybe I'll just do white out.
We can see you right here. That's good.
This is a very interactive interview. Yeah.
Yes.
There you go. I mean, you just have to deal with that. Okay. That's beautiful up here. I wish you could see this. I'm looking over the horse stables and the trees. And
oh, man.
When before we let you go, we'll have you move the camera around and you can show us.
Smell of fresh grass cut. Clean, oxygenated air. Oh, that's wonderful.
Well, I'm in my basement. Not very, you know.
Well,
all right. I'm sorry. I skipped around there. I think it's moving toward professional voices more and more, and they're going to be. And yet, at the same time, at the bottom end, you have indie game producers with access to equipment that cost millions, say 10, 15 years ago. But now, like these fellows who are doing Forgotten Memories, the new game that acting in, they're bringing over some performance capture equipment in the fall, and we're going to shoot and record in Tokyo. So, you know, performance capture, it kind of embodies the shift where back in 2000 when we were doing Silent Hill 2, they had video cameras running and the mocap equipment, and then later they were going to kind of use the video cameras and still images to lay on face and expressions on top of the wireframe that came out of the mocap. Well, now apparently they're able to shoot the video and mocap at the same time with the same equipment. And so that means you're going to get much clearer representation of the actors. And that means you really have to act now.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Let's go into the Yes, Dave told me most of the games he did, including Shenmue and others, because he had done quite a few games before Silent Hill 2. Mm-hmm. He never even did any mocap. He never saw any material from the game. He simply went into a voice booth and recorded the lines. So,
Very cool.
It's quite a different. I don't think we're going to be seeing that. Even at the independent level, we're going to be seeing performance capture. Ooh, yeah. Wow, that's so weird, that image of me.
Huh? It's not bad. It looks good on our, it's pretty good on our end.
Oh, okay. I don't think we're going to be seeing slack performances anymore. I think we're going to get more and more into cinema verite, or even at the independent level. Mm-hmm. And then there'll be bigger and bigger names in the AAA games. That's the way.
Yeah, that's the nature of things.
Yeah.
Our next question is from Young. Young, take it away.
Yeah, so do people ever tell you that you look a lot like James Sunderland? I was looking through images of him, and a lot of people do these Photoshop jobs where they put you alongside him. And back then when you had the haircut, you guys were like identical. So I don't know if they based the character a little bit off of you or something. So what is the story behind that?
I think they did. They made me larger. I'm about 160, and I think James is probably about 200 pounds, or at least 190. Yeah. So they added some size to me and kind of squared off my jaw. But other than that, the hair is the same. My hair's a kind of a mess today, but
and stylish.
Face has some similarities. I'm sure they changed it enough for their own reasons, but also for legal reasons. They definitely didn't. They were aware that they shouldn't use our exact likeness in the, because that wasn't a right that had been discussed.
Right. Oh, I see.
Right. Huh. So I think they, it can't help but be like me. I did hear from Sato that they didn't have preconceived notions on James. They had very clear sketches for Maria before the game started, and for Eddie, and they cast to those pictures. But for James, they were not really fixed on the look.
So he evolved.
I wish they had chosen a more stylish jacket for him, though. I mean, everybody wants me to wear that jacket to when they come to an event where I am. And then I finally found an olive green shirt that I don't mind wearing. But
can't find that jacket. It looked kind of beat up in the game.
Perhaps it was cool for that era. Who knows?
Exactly.
Ronan, you've got the next question, buddy.
All right. So in terms of your voice work in video games as a whole, you've for the most part stuck to horror-themed titles. So, you know, are you a horror fan in general? Would you call yourself a horror fan in general?
No, not at all. I'm a comedy fan. I like comedies. But
you do a lot of horror games,
though. I'll add to that. My wife said something clever. She said that...
Did we lose him?
Did
I just thought he was pondering.
I know.
Yeah, I was like, wow, he ponders very still.
Okay, give us 1 second, guys.
Like, this just got really intense for a second there. Hold on.
He really is pondering. He's really thinking about this one.
He did say he's into comedy. This would be a great way to troll us.
Wow, that was funny. Guy,
an essential element of horror, and I think she might be on something there. So I like comedies, but I somehow got connected with horror.
So for those of you...
I think that the people who make comedies are maybe sad people. And the people who make horror films are really funny and happy people. So maybe games count like that too. You know, we have all heard of famous comedians offing themselves because they were obviously not happy. So you never hear about famous horror movie people offing themselves because they weren't happy.
That is very true.
For those of you who are just joining us or kind of went away on the little break that we had, Ronan was just asking Guy about, you know, whether he was into horror or you know, whatnot. Yes. And Guy just here explained that, you know, he's more of a comedy guy, which is surprising because we don't see in a lot of comedy games. But
if you're interested in my favorites, on my Facebook page, there's a list of all the movies that I like.
There you go. Definitely.
My notes section. And you'll find most of them are comedies, I think.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Well, guys, awesome. My next question for you, and I know this might not be a topic you want to talk about too much, and it's totally okay if you want to pass on it or if you want to talk about a little bit about it with us. I'd like to hear, you know, your side of what happened during this whole Silent Hill HD remake debacle, and then I'd like to know if you guys are all past that. Has everything been resolved? Can you give us some insight on what actually happened? Because a lot of people, I know you've done an interview or two before on, you know, this subject, but a lot of people are still misconstruing information, and some people are saying this thing and some people are saying that thing, and you've actually corrected one of the fans on Facebook the other day about, you know, an issue with Troy Baker. And so I'd like to hear it straight from your mouth. What exactly happened, and what is your stance on the whole Silent Hills HD thing?
Well, the only Konami person that I ever heard from is a lawyer, and he's in charge of licensing at Konami in California. And he sent me an email. I forget when it was, but, you know, a couple, 3 years back there, and it was very curt, and unfortunately it wasn't phrased the way it should have been. It should have been a little bit more friendly. And basically it said we've misplaced, or we can't locate the contracts for the game, so would you please fill this release out and send it back? And then I found out that Dave had gotten one of those, Angela, Donna had gotten one, and Monica had gotten one. I hadn't spoken to Monica in several years, so I used the occasion to write to her, and she was livid. She said, I've got a lawyer. These guys used my face in the making of video, and that's a big no-no. And they definitely blurred your face out, but they left my face in, and she was really upset. And I was like, oh, okay, wow. Well, let me see what I can find out for us. Mm-hmm. And then I wrote back to this fellow, Michael, and I said, well, thank you for contacting us. There are no contracts. That's why you can't find them. They were never produced. I asked for them repeatedly, and they were never forthcoming. So we basically just have a verbal agreement, and I'd be very happy to sign an agreement with you if you will provide me with the following information so that I can do that. Mm-hmm. And then I listed what I needed to know in order to finalize the agreements, because the verbal agreement we had, which was between myself and the executive director of Konami, who came into the set specifically to talk to me about the contracts one day, because I kept asking for my contract and right. They never gave it to me. So that's why I know there was no contract.
Right.
And he came in and he said, okay, PlayStation 2, Japan and the United States, all rights. And I said, oh, okay, that's fine. So technically they could have used my face in the making of video if they had only released it in Japan and the United States. But since they released that video all over the world, they wisely decided to blur my face, because right. I was the one who kept asking about the contracts. They didn't realize Monica was going to take issue with that, but she mm-hmm. did more than I did. I actually wouldn't have minded. It's funny, so that's why I always say about Konami, they can't seem to do anything right for game fans. Whatever they do is either not enough or it's viewed as disingenuous. And in this case, they blurred my face. I wouldn't have minded being in there. And they left Monica's in, and she was upset about it. So,
wow.
Go figure. So, right. So no contracts. And I said, I need to know this information in order to have an intelligent discussion with you. And he said, I'll get back to you shortly. And I never heard from them again.
Oh, wow.
What happened is they then turned around, did the math themselves, because the information I asked for was which countries had it been released in and how many games have they sold in each country. So they kind of figured out right away, ooh, we got a live one here. We better back out yeah. of this talk. And they never talked to me again. That was wow. unfortunate, because the next thing they announced was some made up story about technical issues requiring new audio. The audio we had was, I would say, superior to the new audio. Maybe the voices weren't as good, but the quality of the recording, the studio we used, was superior by far. And some other stories they had come up with. But as I say, the only person from Konami I ever spoke to was this fellow, Michael, who never spoke to him again. Everyone else is essentially a hired worker. So Mary and Troy and even Devin and Tom, they were all, well, maybe Tom, you could argue he was an employee of the California office, but I don't think they really had the depth and connection to headquarters information. There was a lot of miscommunication. Right. So I don't feel badly about it. I very happy that it worked out the way it did. The worst outcome would have been if the original voices had not been included in the HD remake, right, regardless of whether it was technically faulted or not. It just would have, it would have been sad, mm-hmm, I think, for myself and for Monica in particular to have been cut out that way. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what else I have to say. I don't feel that Troy has said or done anything that's made me feel badly towards him. He was just acting on information he got from whoever it was he did talk to, and the same for Mary. And I think they believed what they were saying was correct. I don't think that they you know, were trying to assassinate my character in any way. It may have seemed that way to some fans, but I don't believe that's the case. I think they, you know, they believed in their hearts what they were being told and what they had experienced in their own career. Dave later pointed out to me that he gets money from the re-release of games he's done before. So the idea of not getting additional payments for releases on additional platforms is not true, in particular in Japan. It may be that way in the U.S., where, or Canada, where those guys have recorded in the past, but for Dave in Japan, being paid for additional platforms like a Xbox version or a PS3 version, those should have been, there should have been some money given to the artists.
Oh yeah, definitely. I think every host here on this show is a very big advocate behind voice actors' rights and voice actors getting what they deserve, because you guys bring these characters to life, and we talk a lot about, if this specific character, for instance, Snake in Metal Gear, wasn't voiced by David Hayter originally, it might not have had the same impact on everybody's lives as it did when the game was released. And I believe the same thing goes for Silent Hill 2. As I said, people, a lot of people tend to say that that is the best horror game that's ever been released. So, yeah, we're definitely behind you on that. I'm glad you cleared that up. One last thing I wanted to tack on is actually a community question. It comes from a lot of people want to know this. It was just popped up here in the last few days. Do you have an opinion on Konami making a Silent Hill pachinko machine?
Oh my God.
Fans have all sent me those clips, and they're really upset. And I write back to them, stay strong and don't take it, you know, don't take it hard. But between you and me, fellas, I'm flattered that they think that highly of the game. After all that's gone down, for them to want to make a pachinko game out of it, I'm flattered.
They have like 10 Silent Hill games to choose from, and it seems like the main themes come from two.
Yeah,
right? But I noticed that you noticed they changed the voices.
Yes, I did. A lot of people have issues with the HD re-release voices as well. Like you pointed out, they weren't as good as the original voices. Granted, I've noted in one of my questions here that the voice acting for that far back in time was actually very, very good. Yeah. So yeah, we're definitely behind you on that, but I'd like to go ahead and let Yong get his next question in here.
Yeah, before my next question, I just want to say I'm scared for Metal Gear right now. They turned that into pachinko. I love Metal Gear. It's my favorite franchise. If they turn that into pachinko, I'm going to flip out. So
I assure you Metal Gear Solid will be a pachinko machine. Absolutely.
Oh, man. Well, thank you for that.
No, I have no doubt about that one. If they made Silent Hill into a pachinko machine, why wouldn't they make Metal Gear Solid into a pachinko machine?
You know, I got to be in denial on that so I can live with myself. So that's the route I'll take. But no, I kind of agree with you.
A new generation of gaming fans.
Yay.
Wasn't that what they said? They were going to change the voices for a new generation of gaming fans.
Something along those lines.
Some people's children.
So, next question. Yeah. How would you describe the character of James Sunderland, and what are some things that you had to keep in mind, and maybe what are some directions you were given to play the character? I know you said you had a lot of room to play with him. Was there anything in particular that you really had to keep in mind to get in character, and anything in particular they requested of you?
During the audition, I think the part that cinched it for me was they said, okay, now, okay, do this, okay, mime this, okay, do this. All right, now sit down on the sofa and react to the news that your wife is dead. And there were some lines similar to the bedside scene in the final game. And I started weeping as I was reading the lines, and I was visibly shaking. And I think they understood that I could tap into that level of sadness and remorse at will. And it was because of my difficult first marriage I was just coming out of, where I really, really suffered for years with very, very abusive, psychologically abusive woman. But for the sake of my children, I wanted them to be old enough. Plus, she's Japanese and she's threatening to cut me off from them, and that's very likely in Japan. If you get divorced, the courts give you, the husband, no rights to see the children. So I had to stay married to develop a relationship with them. They hadn't learned to speak English yet. They could only speak Japanese. I was petrified of losing my kids to her. So I struggled through this very difficult, manipulative woman, and then finally managed to escape. I didn't smother her with a pillow. That would have been really terrible for the children, but we had no children. The pillow option was there, right? So I honestly really, really understand that. And I think a lot of fans, especially there are a lot of female women fans of the game, they probably, I don't know, maybe it's such a complicated story. Somewhere in their hearts, they know there's something not right about Mary. It's kind of those demon scenes in the end, and where she's screaming at James and so forth. She's a fairly manipulative woman. That's how I viewed it. So I brought that into the game. There are no lines in there that get into that. It's just James sucking it all in and being quiet, and then, you know, doing her off. But he loves her too. He desperately loves her, and without her, his life is going to have no purpose. So that's why I thought, in many ways, you know, Mary asking James to take care of Laura, Laura needing a family, and James needing some purpose to his life, which is otherwise fairly devoid of purpose. I thought the leave ending made the most sense to me, and that's how I like to think of it. On the other hand, knowing now what I do about Moody Shinju and other Japanese cultural elements, which I didn't know at the time. I hadn't pieced all these things together until years afterwards. I believe the In Water ending is the most beautiful ending, if you follow me. It's the richest one, because it addresses all of these cultural atonement, and there is no answer. I mean, James is, he's damaged goods, and he chooses to end his life to atone for that. In the In Water ending, that's beautiful. On the other hand, it leaves Laura uncared for, and so me being who I am and believing I have four children, believing and taking care of the children the way I do, I think the leave is the one for me. But in terms of sheer cinematic or game beauty, the In Water ending is unsurpassed.
Wow,
that's that makes me look at the game in a whole different way.
I love a voice actor who's knowledgeable of their story. You know, a lot of our voice actors might not have played the game, but they know about it, some of the guys that we've interviewed in the past.
To be honest, I've learned so much of this from fans and from guys like you who analyze games for other people. I haven't had PewDiePie call me yet, but if he does, I'll take the
call. Wow. But
just for my youngest daughter's sake, she watched his videos.
I heard your favorite ending though is the dog ending, correct? That's the one that you
I didn't want to record it. They strong armed me on that one. I finally did it. I'm glad I did. As I've gotten older and I've gotten more involved in the game business and making games myself, and now recording another game, I appreciate what was going on. Remember now, Monica and I came out of Like, we wanted to be actors in some part of our brain. So we took courses in it. We got a degree in it. And then we never did it. So suddenly we're acting in this game. We really acted. We didn't like play. And it was such a rich story. For me, it was an insult to add jokes like that. Kitty jokes at the end of such a deep and heavy performance.
Yeah,
I didn't get it. They got it. I recorded it. I'm glad I did.
That quirky Japanese humor.
Keep it light. Yeah, keep it. Yeah. You know, add a little a little humor to an otherwise very dark story.
Ronan, your next question for Guy.
All right. So I know you talked a little bit about some of the recording sessions that you had, but I was kind of wondering, you know, what it was like when James had those really deep monologue moments where he talked about or questioned whether or not his existence in the world was legitimate and things like that. I was wondering what the direction was like. I know you mentioned that in a previous interview that Sato had kind of given you a little bit of direction about what you were supposed to be feeling in certain scenes, like when he was looking in the mirror and stuff like that to himself. So I was kind of wondering what those sessions were like for those specific moments for you.
Well, I don't really remember thinking about it that much. I remember going into character, getting to a dark place and feeling bad, and then doing my best to clearly express the words I was given. I remember feeling bad for hours after certain days.
Wow.
It took a while. It took a while to get out of James. And my wife was like, look, don't come right home after the studio. Please go out and get, you know, don't bring that back.
Right.
I probably tried too hard, frankly speaking. I don't know.
I think you're fantastic.
Good.
Absolutely. I think it paid off in the end, at least in terms of the quality of the voice work in the game, at least.
I will tell you a funny story, because this is going to segue into Forgotten Memories, the new game, right? So I'm sitting with Dave, and we're totally like wasted one night, just like we do, brainstorming about stuff. He's always got some ideas he's working on, and I'm in venture capital, so I'm always looking at new things, and we bounce things around. And finally, he was recording some stuff for Forgotten Memories, like doing two or three different voice, and I was using my equipment to record him at my office. It was maybe 8-9 o'clock at night. And then finally, he said something to me which really touched my heart, because he's a very good friend. And he said, you know, your performance, when I first heard it, I didn't really think it was very good, to be honest, for Silent Hill 2. And the reason is because it's not like a canned performance, whereas, you know, me and the others, we go in, we get in the studio, we know we've got to do it all in 3 hours and then get out, and we're being paid for that and nothing more. So for us, we've got it all in our head already when we go in. With you, it looked like you were exploring the feelings and the part as you were going. I mean, it's just real. It's just you. So it's affecting. It takes, you can watch it over and over again, and you'll still find something in it. And I was like, oh, wow. Thank you, Dave, because that's how I would like to have it be remembered.
Yeah,
not everyone expresses it that way. And then on the other hand, I don't know if I could do 20 different character voices and you not recognize them all as me. I was very comfortable playing a part that I understood. So here's a guy has very difficult situation with his wife, and it's resolved, not in a great way, but it's resolved, and you play the game and you help him resolve it, and heavy stuff. I don't want to go into a lot of the stuff I get from fans, but I will tell you, a lot of it touches on a very dark places in the psyche, and they say that it helped them through dark times.
That's
so good. I take my responsibility for that very seriously.
Awesome.
Now get into Forgotten Memories. So I'm like filled with an ego rush for here's Dave's professional voice guy. And that's all he does, right? And he's telling me, because you were real, that's why it was good. So I start recording lines for Forgotten Memories, and I'm being real. And this is a game about a man who about my age, and he's dealing with women who seeking to become more independent and empowered and stand alone in the world. And yet he's kind of patriarchal in his thinking and wants to help take care of them. And at they're demanding independence, but at the same time, they're manipulating him with their feminine guiles. Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God, this is like me, my wife, and my three daughters. This is the story continues. So we're Silent Hill allowed me to have a catharsis with my feelings about a difficult marriage. This is going to help me, I hope, in the best case, start to grow and think about how I maybe patronize women without empowering them more. And I, with my daughters, I certainly want to empower them. I want them to be very strong and yet feminine and go out into the world and make good partnerships with whomever they choose and become productive members of society. So I have high hopes for this. And that's why I took the part. The director seemed very sincere. He certainly understood Silent Hill 2. And the first reviews of the first game were pretty good. It's out on iOS and my fans seem to enjoy it. It's the next game will be a lot deeper. So anyway, we're recording a couple of lines, long story short. And Dave says, you're underplaying it. I say, but I'm being real. So now it turns out that me being real is not good.
Okay.
Even the directors sent it back. Even my wife said it was no good. So I said, no. I got to be real. That's where it's at. And it kind of sucked. So I redid all of them, not being real, but being real and on fire.
Yeah.
Real on
fire. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, that sounds awesome.
Very cool.
That's my new strategy. Real on fire.
Real on fire.
Real on fire.
Well, I know.
That's it for all voice actors.
Exactly. Be real and on fire.
Like you guys, right?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Just like us. We're all on fire. But I know we're getting short on time here. We had that that interruption when we lost connection. So I'm actually going to pass questions over to you real quick, Yong, and then we'll back to Ronan, and I'll ask my questions at the very end if we have time. So, okay. Yong, go ahead.
Sure. So going back to James and maybe the script you were giving for Silent Hill 2, I know you talked a lot about some of the dark places you had to tap into, but were there any specific moments in the script that you were like, ooh, that I'm a little uncomfortable with that, or that maybe shocked you a little bit, other than, you know, the dog ending?
No, only the dog ending. Oh, there were a couple of lines that I kind of was hoping we could massage them a little further. One was, this town is full of monsters, and I thought that was childish, but of course it turns out it's a fan favorite, so it's
okay. It's just one of those lines.
Then that worked out well. Yeah. This town is full of monsters, how can you sit there eating pizza? So that one. And then the other one was, I killed a human being. I had a trouble with that one, although they seemed to like it. I didn't feel I was carrying it the way I wanted to, but it seemed okay. Right. And then what was the other one that was tough? Nope, the others I was happy with. There was a scene with of course the dog ending, as you know, I thought that was silly, but that is my voice in Japanese. And they never even showed me the UFO ending. I'm glad they didn't, because I UFO ending. Come on, guys.
Oh boy.
But
so nothing shocking or uncomfortable. Just some stuff you would have preferred to massage and maybe a tweak a little bit to your liking. Basically.
No, nothing uncomfortable. It's certainly a very clean script. There were but there were just things. I mean, we went through it pretty repeatedly on the mocap stage. So for us, and for me, and Monica, and Dave, and all our scenes together were recorded live. And then maybe five or six takes until we were all happy with it. And we went back into the recording studio for the overdub, and we were watching the scene that was selected, edited together, and then we recorded, and it was easy to recall what we had done on stage. So it was not your typical recording type of for game where they never see the game or never play the part together, and then they just go in and individually record their lines. That was more typical back then. I think today we pretty much see them doing what is called performance capture. So it's much more realistic now. And I don't think you can get a big game where if there are two characters interacting, they're not actually interacting, because so much chemistry from being there in, you know, physically and acting together and playing off each other. It's such an improvement in the result.
Yep.
That's true. That's
very cool. True.
Absolutely.
So, Ronan, your next question?
Donna Burke, as many know, she did the voice of Angela in the game. And I was kind of curious if, because we interview a lot of voice actors and actresses, and we typically ask questions of whether or not they were in the same recording booth at the same time. And many of them say yes, many of them say no. So my question to you is, did you and Donna get a chance to actually interact with each other during the voice work at all?
Yes, during the mocap. Mm-hmm. A little bit, because I know she scolded me because I hadn't memorized my lines. The word professional came up, and I think it had an un in front of it. I found a whiteboard in the room, and I had it across behind her, and I had written my lines on them. So I... yeah, right?
Nice.
So she was a little miffed at me, but that's okay. She's a pro, and we pulled it off. At the audio, no one was in the booth at the same time.
Oh, wow.
When we got to the audio stage, no one was acting. Everyone was just recalling and recording. So one by one, we would just watch the scene play. We had the earphones, and we would record our line almost over what was on the scratchy video version of it.
Yeah,
and then there was, but in the mocap session, there were a number of times where everyone was crying after the, especially those bedside scenes with James and Mary dying, and her forgiving him. Those were very heavy. You can't, I guess you see it because obviously it's moved a lot of people. So
absolutely.
I was hope that answers your question, Ronan.
Oh, no, absolutely does. I kind of have an add-on part to that question as well. I know Angela's character, as in general, she's supposed to be the kind of character that's not all the way there mentally, like supposed to be kind of the drifting away sort of character in a sense. So my question is, how was it for you to try to act and react to to moments like that where she seemed like she wasn't there mentally?
I didn't find it difficult. Let me put it that way. And I've had brushes with crazy women for years. Having her act crazy and, you know, having dealt... Usually you just want to remain calm, not get baited into... it's like you're walking on broken glass and you've got to be careful when you're... You certainly don't want to trip and fall. You want to keep your balance.
Right.
You're constantly looking for signs. And so that's how I acted those parts, but, you know, reserved. Mm-hmm. I think there's only one part where she got through to me and I reacted without thinking, which I felt was appropriate. It's where she suggested I was going to kill myself. Mm-hmm. And then I said that I would never do that.
Oh, wow.
All right. Well, that's crazy.
Did Donna Burke sing at all at the time? Because she sings for one of the themes for Metal Gear Solid 5, or she sings various themes, actually. She did overdubbed some of the classics, and she also... Wow.
That's her main thing. She's a jazz singer and a vocalist, and she brought one of her albums and gave me a copy of it.
Oh, wow.
Very cool. Awesome.
Very cool.
That was before she told me I was unprofessional. How are you? You know, who are you? Well, I'm Donna Burke. I'm a singer, and okay. So she identified herself as a singer to me first and foremost.
That's awesome.
Wow. That's really awesome.
You can actually take the next question, buddy.
Are you gonna me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Oh, cool. Okay. I would like to shift topics to Silent Hills. Just, it seems that you know about the game based on how you've talked about Norman Reedus and whatnot. So, my question to you is just, what did you think of it when you saw it? You know, what do you think about Hideo Kojima and Del Toro sort of partnering up for this project? And also, have you played PT, the playable teaser for the game?
I I thought, gee, I hope they call me. And then I thought, no, I haven't played PT. I like comedies, remember?
Right.
And
right.
Then I guess I checked out who Del Toro is. I know Norman Reedus because I had watched a couple of episodes of Walking Dead, so I knew of him. Right. I think I checked into his background to see what else he had done. He's been around, he's a pro, you know, he's been doing, yep. That's his thing. He's been doing it a long time. Kind of like the guy who did Breaking Bad. I've forgotten his name right now.
Bryan Cranston?
Yeah, Bryan Cranston, who seemed to have come out of nowhere, but has been acting his whole adult life. He's a professional, and he was fantastic in that. So Norman Reedus is the same. I have tremendous respect for the fellow, and I certainly hope that something does come of their efforts, because they've put some thought into it already. Mm-hmm. Business-wise, it was a disaster in the making and never had a shot of ever happening. Yeah. That's my look at it. The CEO or the chairman of Konami can't stand Kojima and finally got a reason to fire him. You know, there was a kind of a comedy video going around of the fellow who did Final Fantasy, and he kept coming up with crazier and crazier ideas in an effort to get fired, which is what this comedy video he made for of himself. And I think Kojima in some ways threw down this gauntlet in front of the chairman, and it had to happen. I can't imagine that he saw it ending any other way.
Yeah.
It was just so over the top. Metal Gear Solid, way over budget. That Fox engine eating cash. And the whole company heading toward legal gambling in Japan, which is coming later this year. It'll be voted on later this month.
Wow. Yep.
And, you know, that's why they've got these pachinko machines coming out. But that's not the real end game. The real end game is gambling on mobile phones and mobile devices. That was what was in that coded message, not so coded, from the CEO, the chairman. He's saying, we're going to focus on mobile.
Yeah.
And what they didn't say is mobile gambling. But gosh, if you could take over even 20% of mobile gambling in Japan over the next two decades, say, we're talking billions of dollars. Yeah. It's a huge, huge opportunities. So they all hands to that, and why waste money on the Fox engine, which probably didn't really work so good. But I'm sorry, that's my feelings on that. Kojima has a lot of fans, and I researched him carefully too, so I would understand more about him. He started out as a coder and a designer, and Metal Gear Solid was his baby. He created the genre, so to speak, of stealth military type games. And I have a lot of respect for his creativity and what he did. He just as a businessman kind of blew it, because he could still be there. But we'll see. You know, now he's off on his own, and he can and he's got Del Toro who wants to still work with him. He make a new company and get it funded and make some. We'll see what he can do.
You seem to have a real solid grasp on that.
And
guy.
if he's watching, give me a call, man. Yeah, right. I'll do something with you. Yeah. I'll check my schedule book.
The first time we've heard that. But Ronan, was that your last question, the one that you had?
Yeah. Okay. The pre-sold was the last
question. Well, I know we're right there at the tail end of the interview. So, Yong, if you want to take it over, I know you got one other question, and then you got like a couple small community questions, and then we can wrap this up. Is that all right, Ronan? Okay.
My last question to you is simply, are you a gamer? Do you play games? And how many of the Silent Hill games have you played? Although you did say that you're not a fan of horror games, so I'm assuming that you haven't played a lot of the Silent Hill games.
I've just done the playthrough with my friend at the controls and made a video of that. You can see on my YouTube channel. I have played video games. I play with the kids. I had the original family computer, the original Nintendo box.
Wow.
sometimes my children will still try to beat me at Mario Kart or something like that. I don't have any of the fancy games. I hate to admit this, but I got addicted to a first-person shooter game for about 5 or 6 months.
Wow.
And then that was it. I did it. I went there and I did that. But that experience was very helpful in understanding how players form a bond with the characters in the game. Right. So the sergeant who, of the team, it was called, what was that game called? Modern Warfare.
Oh, Call of Duty Modern Warfare.
Call of Duty,
Call of Duty Modern Warfare. Yeah. Because you could play it on the Nintendo Wii, which is what we own at home. So.
Oh, okay, it, right, yes.
And yeah, I got really into that. Those were great characters who acted that. I really enjoyed that. So that's my story about playing games. I probably should play more of them, but now I have a team of five. We're working on Words and Monsters, which is our game for learning language.
Very cool.
And they all grew up playing RPG games, so we're kind of leaning in that direction. They're more knowledgeable on them, and they're my front end and back end coders and my content people. So
that sounds very cool.
Sounds really cool.
When is that project slated to come out?
Geez, I'm hoping to release a beta in the fall, and I wish I could say that the final game will be out in this year, but. It's complicated.
Where can people that are interested in checking that out? Because that's something I wanted to ask you towards the end. And since we're right there, we might as well just get it out there. We've got almost 300 and something other people watching right now. So anybody that's interested, where can they go ahead and learn about this game? Do you have like a website up for it? Do you have a place where you put out information on it?
On Facebook, there's a Words and Monsters page. They can go there. And I've linked to a demo video that shows... the prototype of the battle scenes.
Awesome.
That's up there.
Very cool.
It's I don't know if you've played Final Fantasy, Dragon Quest or Paired Associate method of learning language. And your work, matching the words, is advancing your character through these islands and saving the world. Probably the same as most RPG type games.
Finally, learning can be fun. So,
well, I'm giving a presentation at a conference on neurolinguistics in September, and it's getting into the science of uncertainty, which causes attraction and addiction. So I would like to do a little research on the science of horror and why that causes an addiction as well. But I'm working on the science of uncertainty. Sure. And apparently pachinko has a lot to do with that. Slot machines have a lot to do with it. And
hopefully
a good RPG game has a lot to do with uncertainties as well. It heightens the production of dopamine in the brain, which is makes you feel good and you want more of it. So you know, it's pretty cool stuff. So I've been doing I'm going to publish a paper on that subject.
That sounds great.
Sounds really cool.
All right, well, Yong, it's got a couple quick little community questions for you guys. So, Yong, go ahead and take it away. And thank you to the community for these questions. We definitely appreciate that. I know it was short notice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just a couple. The first one is from SigmaYX from YouTube. Are you friends with Akira Yamaoka, the composer of the Silent Hill series? Have you met him at all?
He's an acquaintance. I would like to call him a friend, but he's a rock star. So, he's... I hope he's a friend. We're connected on Facebook. I've written to him recently. I'm trying to get him to agree to write the music for my Forgotten Memories game.
Very cool.
Wow. That'd be very cool indeed.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be cool?
That would be very cool.
We lost your video, just so you know.
We've still got the audio, though. Okay. So.
Cool. I just wanted to make you aware.
Oh, there we go. My video's back. Okay. Multiple... this one was already answered. A lot of users were asking, what's your favorite ending? Which one do you think it's canon? You answered both, so we'll skip that one. Sebastian Hernandez from YouTube. What was your absolute favorite part of Silent Hill 2? What was your favorite moment?
Ooh.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a heavy scene, but it's because it was so satisfying. The bedroom scene between James and Mary where... he confesses and she forgives him. It was just so rich and satisfying to have done a good job of it.
Mm-hmm.
Very
cool. Mr. Fish 291 from YouTube. Do you feel attachments to Silent Hill, or was it just a job? I know I'm sure you feel attachment now, but back then when you were starting out with this project, Was it just a job, or did you feel somewhat attached to it after you were done with the project?
I never do jobs. I don't do jobs. I put everything I have into whatever I'm doing. That's the way I've always been. So I was totally into it when I was doing it. Mm-hmm. Sadly, Konami didn't keep up with us or take advantage of us to drive sales even further. And I had no idea that the game had become a success because I didn't play games and I didn't know. I was locked away in Japan, and it's not popular in Japan. So I was very happy to learn that it was a big success and that there are fans, and they tracked me down. And I just had a fan event in Milwaukee. I had 25 people come, and we had a pizza party, and I signed things. Oh, nice. I don't go to conventions, and I do not sign things through the mail, so please don't send at me requests. I don't do it through, it's not real. So if I meet you, I'm happy to sign things and shake your hands, but I don't send things through the mail. So I had done, then I stopped again in Cleveland and met fans there. That was really fun. And I always learn so much from them, and they're so sincere after all these years.
Yeah.
Very cool. And that's my last question.
All right. Well, that pretty much wraps it up. We do like to do one thing, Guy, and it's, I hope it's not asking too much, but we usually like to have our guests say some lines from the game that they have, and we put it as kind of an intro at the beginning of the, because this video will be up on YouTube as well. Would you mind doing a line or two for us in James's voice?
I'll be happy to. And this was a line that Jesse asked me to record this at the fan event, and it's one that I don't normally do, but it's pretty cool. I was weak. That's why I needed you. Needed you to punish me for my sins. That's all over now. I know the truth. Now it's time to end this.
Nice. Very cool. That's awesome. Got two smaller ones here. I'm going to put them in the Skype chat. That one right there is the right when he's about to go into the town. It should look a little familiar to you. And then I've got one.
Are those verbatim, or are you remembering them?
I have them. I when I did some research before.
So these are verbatim?
Yeah, they're verbatim, right from the game. And then here's the last one.
All right.
There we go. And I apologize to the audience for the screens being a little messed up while I send that over to Guy. All right. Yeah. So those two that we have there, those are two pretty good lines.
Okay. I've got them in front of me. I'm ready.
All right. Perfect. All right. Well, I'll shut up.
I guess I really don't care if it's dangerous or not. I'm going to town either way. Don't worry. I'm not crazy. At least, I don't think so.
Nice. Thank you so much, Guy. Before we let you go, is there anything you'd like to say to the fans? Like I said, we've got a couple hundred in here watching you live. If there's anything you'd like to plug or shout out, I know you got the new game coming out. I know you have the Forgotten Memories as well. I know you got a Facebook page. So anything like that you'd like to tell them about, feel free to go ahead.
Yeah, please like my Facebook page and keep up on my my game work there. And thank you all very, very much for your kindness to me and the other actors over the years, and your faith and support for Silent Hill 2. And stay silent.
Very nice.
Thank you very much, Guy. We look forward to all of your work coming out. Hopefully we'll see a lot more of you here in the future. You've got an amazing voice for the video game industry, and we're all so happy to have you. Ronan and Yong, anything else for Guy before we let him go?
Just once again, thank you so much for joining us. That was some awesome insight you gave us, and it made me look at the game in a whole new different way. Yeah. So just thank you for being so dedicated to the game that you worked on for us fans and whatnot. And just we really appreciate all the work you've done.
Yeah, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, fellas. Have
all right,
a great
guy.
Day.
Enjoy the rest of your day. Get outside and enjoy that air.
I'm going paddle boarding on the lake.
Oh, man. I'm
That's
jealous.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, right. Be safe out there, man. We'll see you. Hopefully, we'll have you on the show again another time. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
There.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was Guy Sihe. Thank you for tuning in for another great interview. How did you guys like that one?
That was fantastic. Yeah.
Yep. Wow, that was really insane.
Y'all are twinsies.
Oh, yeah, we're totally twins, obviously.
Absolutely. I mean, they used to call me Blazin' back in high school, so, you know, it's totally fine.
Wow. Me too. What a coincidence.
Wow. All right. Well, we're going to have a quick post show. I don't have a ton of time today to do. You had two episodes of the Codec this week. So we're going to make this one. It's not going to be super short, but we definitely got a couple little things to talk about. So let's just let's get right into it. No commercials, no nothing. Let's just go ahead and talk. So quickly, the first thing that I would like to talk about is we have the new Metal Gear Mother Base gameplay out.
Oh, man.
Wow.
Dude.
Dude, right? That's what I said. A lot of insightful things, not just for Mother Base, but for your FOB system as well. Totally, totally makes Metal Gear Online not coming out on time an okay thing for me.
Yeah.
Even though I have to wait longer than most. So, Yong, I'd like to start off with you. Just overall impressions and maybe your favorite thing that you saw from there. I hope it's not the hand of Jehudi, because what the hell is that thing, right?
Oh, man. You don't know what that is at all? Really?
I don't.
From Zone of the Enders.
Yes. The ability you get.
Yeah.
I never got to play that.
It does exactly what that does in Zone of the Enders. You can grab objects from afar with something called the Wisp. And the arm, if you look at it, it actually says Wisp. It's basically a reference to Zone of the Enders, which is a Hideo Kojima game.
Yeah, right. I know about awesome the game. I just never got to play it. Is that the blue arm that we saw teased?
Well, the mech is, he has like a blue-yellow combo.
Yeah, it's kind of like a clawish mech arm.
Yeah, okay. It's a cool reference to that, which is really cool. And I don't know if you saw this, but Kiefer actually does the battle cry.
They said people would recognize it.
Yeah. So that's what that was. But once again, oh man, FOB man looks so freaking sick.
It's a lot bigger than I thought.
Yeah. No. Yeah. The one thing I'm worried about is if I'm in this really important mission and then bam, FOB is being invaded. Oh, one moment, Zero. Let me be right back. gotta deal with my FOB. We'll talk later. But Jesus, I'm more hyped than ever for that game now. Mother Base, first of all, is freaking huge. It's a lot bigger than I ever expected it to be.
Yeah.
But FOB is what really, really drew my attention, and
It's a different layout than Mother Base.
Yeah, yeah. It's a little different than what we saw in the Gamescom 2014 gameplay demo at the end. A lot of little changes. But I really liked the wormhole extraction.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Nanomachines, I'm telling you.
Yeah, nanomachines. And honestly, if there's wormholes in this game, hell, why not nanomachines?
Right.
And it acknowledges them as wormholes. It says, like, in the map marker, it says wormhole, like, right there.
Yeah.
It's not just, like, a cute phrase for it. It says wormhole right here. So
nobody bats an eye. For them, it's, like, a normal occurrence.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
It's the 80s, the aliens and stuff, Roswell.
Yeah, 80s aliens. Yeah. I guess it kind of makes sense.
There you go.
But, I mean, I don't know what else to say except that it looks awesome. And you can make multiple FOBs, which is great. I don't know if you have to like guard all of them at once or how that's going to work. The reward and consequence system is awesome.
Yeah.
The way everything works, you tag a target, and then if you lose him, the marker will eventually go away. So you got to find him again.
Right.
And it just, but you always know that there is an invader. There's a timer, and you get this notification. It's a matter of finding him. So. You will never be able to infiltrate a base without them knowing. They'll know that you're there, but they just won't know where. And so it's going to be a struggle for them to look for you. And I feel like they thought about this like extensively, and everything just makes sense. And I don't know what else to say. It's going to be awesome.
There's one concern for me in that point, and you actually make a great you pointed it out, is you'll always, if you do always know somebody is invading your base, I feel like that kind of sets up the ability for people to camp the one place that you have to go. So that's the only concern that I have, is somebody just sitting right by the, you know, the entrance of it. Granted, obviously it would make it a little easier for the infiltrator to, you know, figure out, you know, he's just got to get a quick look up at the target. And if the guy's there, then maybe you can snipe him or, you know, distract him in some way. But also I feel like it, for a really skilled player, if they just kind of guard that platform core, that might make the gameplay a little less intense. So hopefully there'll be some way to maybe remain maybe undetected when you invade, or something like that. Or there'll be, hopefully there might be like, you can't stay on the core platform for the first X amount of time or something like that. Something like that would definitely be fine, but it definitely is cool. And I'm really excited. What was your favorite part though, Yong, of the trailer? What was your, like the one thing that was, you were like, oh, that was so cool.
I don't know. It's just the whole thing just came together so well. I mean, it's the whole, watching the whole thing that really sold it. It wasn't just one specific part. It's just how every little piece came together was what really hyped me up. I loved the arm, the Wisp bionic arm. I mean, that's just, I gotta get that out there. I don't think I have one particular favorite part. It's a culmination of how everything just came together so perfectly, and how everything was just so well presented, showing you just the possibilities of this being able to infiltrate basically infinite number of different mother bases. And I thought that was very cool. About your concern for the people who might camp on the platform core, if they do that though, they won't be able to do anything. They won't be able to collect resources to build up their base. They won't be able to do missions. They won't be able to do anything. So I think that's the drawback.
Once the game is started, once it's like, once you get into somebody's platform that they built, if they just kind of hang out at the core, but yet you kind of just, you know, triggered my senses there. If they just stay there, they're not going to be able to stop you from fultoning out their personnel their equipment. Right. So they'll have to rely on their on their soldiers.
And also, you'll be really easy to, like, if he has a sniper rifle, boom, headshot. Yeah. Like, you won't know where he is. Yeah. Headshot, and that's it. You know, you're done. You got to redeploy. So I feel like, it's a culmination of how everything was so well balanced and comes together. I'm going to have to play it, of course, before I can actually make a final judgment. But from what I've seen, everything just looks perfect and awesome.
It does look amazing. Absolutely. I think for me, the biggest thing that I liked was the size. You could have this huge base, and then I saw a stat on when he was going through the iDroid of he had like 1,000-something members of the combined platforms and stuff. And he wasn't max level. So I thought that was the really cool thing for me. I'm really big on, like, I'll recruit, like, individual personnel. Like, in Peace Walker, I don't auto-put anybody anywhere. I manage everything. I like that kind of base management thing. So that, for me, was the biggest thing. Right. But, Ronan, what about you, man? I know, did you get to do the live impressions, or did you not do that?
I didn't get a chance to get around to that. Okay. I ended up just watching it off stream that day when I finished my stream. The first thing that came to my mind was Metal Gear is esports now, ladies and gentlemen.
I can't wait to open that on Frag Nation's ladder system. I can't wait. I'm going to dominate that.
It was great because, like, I was watching that, and as they were kind of going back and forth about who was going to, you know, actually, if the invader was going to get away, I was like on pins and needles trying to figure out who's going to win. Probably the most intense thing I've seen all week. But outside of that, I really enjoy the subtle aspects they added to it, like the Jehoti arm and stuff like that, considering. Yep. And I almost shed a small tear seeing that, because there will not be a Zone of the Enders 3, and that makes me really sad on the inside. But I did think that was pretty awesome. And I did enjoy the fact that there's so many different ways that you can either defend your base, or if you're the attacker or the invader, for example, have many different decoys and weapons to use to basically stop the opponent from either taking you out or you getting away, whatever that might be. I think it opens up a lot of varied options for the way these situations will go down. And I think that might be one of the coolest aspects about it, for me at least. I did like the fact that the bases can be incredibly expansive in so many different ways. And watching the demo where they got to the second half of that, and he was just driving in the Jeep down the pathway for like several minutes before he actually got to the main base. It threw me for a complete loop about how large these bases can actually be.
That's awesome.
I'm at a point where I'm like, I don't know if I should stream those things, because in the streaming world, we have this thing called stream sniping. Because there's always a viewer out there that is watching your stream and making sure they find out exactly where you are every time so that they can snipe you. So
I gotta
make sure that I put a delay on the stream if I do that so they can't catch me.
Ghosting, man. It's a thing of esports. But do you have any concerns, Ronan, for the intruder of the mother base portion of the gameplay, being that it's one-on-one on all of the AI? Which by no means is a pushover. I can't begin to commend them for their AI work. It seems really good. They check in with each other. They check out when security cameras go down, just like in Ground Zeroes. And if Ground Zeroes is any indication, they'll actually kind of form up in little small fire teams and go out and check out these little things. I was actually playing Ground Zeroes the other day, and I got spotted, and originally, based on what I just remembered playing, there was just only going to be like one or two guys, but they had a full team of four looking for me. So do you think the intruder, is that kind of a disadvantage here, having to go up against AI and a player?
I think in a way they're going to have to be, because you're the one that's deciding, okay, I got
it's
the
like
balls.
Your choice, motherfucker.
to step up to somebody else's base and try to invade it and steal stuff from it. I think that there should be a little bit of a repercussion in place for doing so. Now, granted, this is not to slight the AI in any way whatsoever. Granted, I feel like the biggest concern you're going to have is the other player, basically, when it comes to the combat scenarios, because they're the ones that have unpredictable intelligence, of course. So I do think that, when you go there, when the person decides they want to invade, they make sure, you have to make sure that you go prepared. You bring everything that you possibly can, whether that be different armor, weapons, whatever that may be. I think that there's a ways to counter that. Like, for example, they showed off the prototype stealth camo, for example.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, which I thought was really cool. So you have things like that you can use in your arsenal to help you perhaps avoid getting noticed or seen by perhaps the AI, for example.
Actually, I don't think you can use the stealth camo in FOV.
Oh, really? Okay, that you guess you're out of luck. What were you going to say?
One thing I did notice, and this came from the chat, is during the last demo, like Yong talked about, we saw, I forget the guy's name, the guy that does the English voiceover for the
Sean
demos.
Eichstone.
Yes.
Yeah.
We saw him doing the infiltration during the last year's gameplay trailer, and it didn't seem like the base was alerted like they were in this newer one. He fultoned out a couple soldiers, and he fultoned out a crate without anybody really noticing anything. So it could be that maybe that this player's base that we saw earlier has like a early warning detection system where if it detects like a wormhole, it automatically goes on alert, and then you get that timer, as opposed to maybe the other one whose base didn't seem as big as this new one. It could be like you can infiltrate those bases without anybody knowing until they actually spot
and
you.
They kind of showed a little bit of like I want to say sensors or traps and stuff like that to detect the player. For example, they showed one in a little walkway where they had the sensor there and a camera, but the camera didn't have a gun. It was just a camera on it. Right. So perhaps there is a means for the player to invade the base without being detected ahead of time.
Yeah.
So that I'm kind of curious to see where that goes as well.
That's a great point. And Yong, I'm curious on your thoughts on this. I feel like some of the stuff there is just a little too easy. Like that laser system is right there. You can clearly see it, and he took it out in one shot. Do you think that's going to be an issue, Yong?
That's a good question. You do alert some guards if you shoot them down, and it does delay the guy from reaching the core. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the security stuff, it does seem like you have to really find a good placement for them. Because from what I saw, it's clearly visible that there is a wall of lasers and a freaking camera glowing, with a green light.
And he took it out like one shot. Like one shot took out the laser system. Granted, that alerts the base, but do you think that we'll have the option to place these things where we want, or do you think it'll just kind of be like if we order lasers, it'll just put lasers wherever they go?
They showed it in the in the demo that you can place. Now it's not like it's like Sims where you can place the exact location of there are very specific spots within. So there's like point A, point B, point C, point D, and it shows you in the menu where they can be placed. And there's like bunch of them per platform, but they are specific locations from what I saw. It's just there are a variety of options to choose from.
Awesome. Well, that's super, super exciting. Do you think, Yong, that you will have an analysis out before the game comes out? You've got a lot of analysis to do.
There's like 10 different videos that came out from Gamescom. Yes, I don't think I'll be able to analyze all of them by the time the game comes out, especially with some stuff that's coming up. So I'll try to have as much of them as done as possible, but no, there's no way I'm going to analyze all of them. So at this point, with the game so close to release, I feel like maybe we should just leave some surprises for when the game launches.
Exactly. I think I've seen the 18 minute little gameplay demo where they did the Heroes Way again. I saw that, and I saw the Gamescom demo. Did I miss anything else besides those two?
Nope. What I have seen, that's pretty much it.
Yeah. Cool. I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't out of the loop because I didn't even get to see that little gameplay demo until late last night. Yeah. So super, super excited. I thought that was pretty cool. He showed off a new way to tackle that mission. But I think that'll wrap up our post show, guys. We've got another interview next week with Heather Haley, which I'm super excited to talk to paramedic Dr. Clark about her work in Metal Gear Solid 3 and maybe see if she might be in this new game in some
question
way.
One, are you an MGS5?
Tell us secrets now. So I'm looking forward to talking to her. I'm friends with her on Facebook and she seems like an incredibly lovely lady, so I'm super excited to talk to her. She always posting like cute dog videos and stuff, so can't wait to see how she feels about being in Metal Gear when she seems like such a peace loving lady. So definitely excited for that. Ronan, final thoughts, goodbyes, and anything coming up for you, buddy?
Right now, for me, I'm going to be starting the Metal Gear month, quote unquote, on Monday next week. So I'll be playing through Metal Gear Solid 1 on Monday. I don't know how long I'm going to go on that day. I guess it's until I feel like I want to stop. So nothing set in stone on that one just yet. But yeah, that'll kick off the.
You could
the
probably
Metal Gear
beat
month.
That game in one day. I beat it the night before the David Hayter stream. So
yeah, so it's that'll happen then. I'll probably get past that depending on how I pace it out during the week. This week I don't know for sure if there's going to be a podcast. I know my co-host said they're going to be going off on vacation pretty soon here, so. I'll keep you guys posted on that. But that was a fantastic interview, by the way.
You can always invite me. I can be a ninja.
There you go. I thought you already were. What happened?
Do I look like a ninja? Dude, they will spot me in the nighttime
you're white enough.
Daylight infiltration only. I blend in with the sun.
I mean, if there was snow outside, I'm sure you'd disappear.
Right? Snow light infiltrations only.
I'm at a disadvantage. I'm just yellow.
Well, you see that. Afghanistan's a big place.
The desert. That's right. The desert. Plenty of sand around. Here, all kinds of environment.
We got it covered, guys. It's fine.
Yeah, we got it.
So possibly, maybe no podcast. You'll give us some more.
I still got to get the previous one posted because, like I said, I ran into issues with Windows 10 and my editing software. So I'm going to try to have that posted soon. Just no guarantees on when just yet. But that's great. Like I said, the interview was fantastic. I didn't really realize how often he had to go into really dark places to draw from for his character.
I think that's really cool, but I think it's also kind of scary at the same time.
It is kind of scary and a little depressing at the same time, but when you look at Silent Hill as a whole, they're all really depressing.
Yes, they are. They're ultra depressing games. Like, I've played horror games before and just been like, all right, that was a cool horror game, but Silent Hill makes you feel in the heart.
Yeah, you really feel something that sticks with you after a while. That was a lot of fun, and props to him for actually being able to sit there and talk about that, considering a lot of the things he brought up during the interview, which I know was probably hard to talk about in some sense. I know I watched his previous interview with another person here on Hitbox that interviewed him.
Really?
And he did an interview. But there's a Let's Play on YouTube with another guy he did an interview with on Hitbox that I watched yesterday, in fact. This is for this interview, and he touched on that subject a little bit during that that video, but he didn't go into it as deep as we did for this one. I kind of felt bad because I'm like, this keeps going back into that place, and I keep asking him those questions. Maybe I should just stop asking questions.
to talk about it, though.
Talk about your feelings, man. But as always, guys, thank you all for watching this exciting episode of the Codec. That was really informative, And it was great to get his opinions on that. So as always, guys, we will see you on the next episode, or I will see you on the next episode. So thanks for tuning in. You guys, stay classy, stay sharp, don't do anything I wouldn't do, and I'll see you next time.
All right. Thank you so much, Ronan. And yeah, guys, like I said during the last episode of the Codec here on Wednesday, check us out on Twitter and Facebook. It's at @_Codec on Twitter, and it's The Codec on Facebook. There's also a podcast garden link that I've been putting up if you're looking to watch these interviews on MP3 format. And it is the only way that you can see all of the interviews in one place. Some interviews are on Yong's channel. Some are on my channel. Some are not anywhere but uploaded here. So if you want to see every episode, even the ones before we were the Codec, that's the place where you can check all of those out. And other than that, we have, like I said, Heather Haley this coming up week. We've got some fun things planned for you guys in the following weeks after that. So make sure you keep up to date. Stay tuned for all that kind of nonsense. And if you haven't, go watch the intro for the, I think it's episode 10 of the Codec, and watch Yong say skull face blah 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 blah. That's my favorite intro ever. I really just
beautiful Texan accent, you know.
I think it's only fitting, since we talked a little bit about Troy Baker today, that we all go back and remember that episode. Oh, which is my favorite intro of all time. So with that, I would like to thank everybody for coming again. Make sure you subscribe to the channel. There's a blue button. It looks like a little box. If you're not already subscribed, go ahead and click that follow button, so you can be updated on when we go live here for these interviews. We definitely appreciate all the support. And there is a green subscribe button if you'd like to subscribe. And as my boss has pointed out, I tend to forget to do this a lot, but I'd like to thank our sponsors. I really do appreciate them. I just forget sometimes to mention it. Their logos are right here to my left and to my right. We've got BattleBox, Hitbox, Control Freak, and Frag Nation and Steel Series. Thank you guys so much. If I don't give you the credit that you deserve, sponsors, we love you. We were wearing your stuff. We talk about you. Just I forget sometimes, so don't hate
long
me.
Time.
Love you long time.
Long time. All right. Yeah. So with that said, I'd like to switch it over to Yong. Any last words? Anything going on for you, Yong? When's our next analysis, please?
Next analysis should be either I think tomorrow is going to be the next. I'm analyzing the short the Gamescom 2015 trailer. That one's a right. pretty short one to analyze, so that didn't take me too long.
So we got something
gameplay
coming.
Stuff. Yeah, the gameplay stuff though, man. It's a lot of gameplay. So I'll see what I can do, but I don't know if I can get all of them out in time. So I'll do as much as I can.
We need like one more good analysis before the game launches. This is one. Give us one. One more good
yeah.
one.
I mean, it's just the E3 2015 trailer was that was like the pinnacle of Kojima trailers. So I don't know if I can ever top that one. You know, that was an hour and 40 something minutes on a 6 minute footage. I mean, I lost it. Anyway, yeah, so I'll try to release as many analysis as I can. Just don't expect all of them in time. And I've got the retrospective going on. Yep. And I'm discovering some new things myself, just looking back at some of the stuff. It's really cool just how many hints there really were about the game, looking back at all the tweets and the things when Kojima's tweet wasn't as popular. So I'll talk all about that.
Love that. And the retrospective thing is great, man, by the way. I don't mean cut you off, but I just wanted to say that I thought that was a great idea. And
yes, it is.
Thank you.
During your last retrospective, we actually got to see what Big Boss would look like if he still had a left arm.
Yeah, I forgot. Cool. I totally even forgot to mention that, which I'll talk about today, tonight. But I think, I don't know if they did that to avoid spoilers or if that wasn't in the books, in the plans back then, if Big Boss wasn't supposed to have a prosthetic arm. One of those two things. But it's cool that he does now, because we get stuff like the Jehudi arm and the rocket, the punch, and the all the other things. So, you know, I'm happy they made that change. But I survived. I haven't slept in 20-something hours. Caffeine's wearing off, so this is a good time to end. You know, it's at a point where I'm starting to get dizzy now, and I'm feeling kind of like an out of body experience, that kind of thing. That's how tired I am right now. So I should probably end this episode of the Codec. Thank you for tuning in. I had a blast. Awesome job again. You too, and be sure you guys to subscribe to the Nation Fusion Hitbox to be updated on these live streams and interviews, and check us all out. We all do awesome stuff. So with that, I will see you guys next time. Yong out.
Bye.